Trust in the process. Yeah, the process. Thank God for you. Trust in the process of salvation. Salvation is a process. And it's a foundation. No other foundation that can be laid other than that which is laid, and it is Jesus Christ. God is the one making it grow, not the pastor. So many people blame the pastor for this not happening and that's not happening. Well, we're going to talk about something this morning. All right? Now, the overall topic, trusting the process of salvation's foundation. Now, this is something we need to come to grips with right here. And write this down. God will not hold us accountable for the outcome. God will not hold us accountable for the outcome. Only for our efforts. He's holding you accountable for your efforts. That's saying a lot. So we want to put it all on God. God this, God that. And the bad teaching that the church have gotten, that the body of Christ bear no responsibility, because once saved, always saved, I can go back to living a sinful life and I'm good. So where did they get that teaching from? Because it's been spewed out over the pulpit. Can I say this? I'm not bringing, trying to hurt or damage anything by saying this. The black churches have been used for civil rights work more so than the word of God. God's word. God's word. There's no doubt. We know history. We don't need to give. But we got a system by God that's been put in place. Now, I talked about some things, and I gave a definition of process. There are so many Greek words from understanding of this word. We gave 1382. We gave 50, 55 in the Greek, 363. We got 3403, 2392. We got 393. We got 38. We got 5505. All these are Greek meanings of the word process. But I will hit you with this one. With these two, 2392, supernaturally healing, the spiritual process of God's grace causing supernatural divine healing. That's God's grace. But so many remain in the pews still unhealed through his grace. Oh, I'm saved by his grace. Well, allow the grace to heal you. Because so many people have, and I know this, I'm speaking from personal experience. I thought it was what was going on in the church that was hurt me when I came in. It wasn't that. I was already damaged. The world did a number on me. I was born in sin, shaped in iniquity. So I was hurt when I came in. The church didn't hurt you. You was hurt before you got here. But we won't allow God to heal it. And we want to remain that way to say the church ain't this and the church ain't that. I'm talking from experience. Now, here go the deal. The area that I was messed up in, I allowed God to heal it. That no longer bothers me now. How did I allow that? I allowed his word in those areas that I thought somebody was bothering me in. It was me all the time, undeveloped in those areas. I'm looking at it for what it is. And I allowed God's teaching on the subject to get in that area. And I'm better for it. And I know the process of it now. I know the inner workings of it. So it ain't, I gave my life to Jesus Christ and I'm on my way. Can you imagine going out of this world to God to clean this world up, and it's a lot of undeveloped people in heaven that did not develop, did not grow, did not overcome anything? Is that what heaven gonna look like? Well, what's gonna happen if we don't go through the process? What if we don't trust the process of growing up? All right? We got to get supernaturally healed, divine healing. All right? 393, set out a goal. God has a goal, the process, the making, 38, the making or becoming holy. Uh-oh. That's what the end goal of the process is going to have you, holy like God, set apart, sanctified, holiness, 5505, the need to deliver something, give birth. You're going to give birth. It's a birthing. You're going to give birth to maturity. But the average person said, I'm on my way to glory. May the work I done speak for me. Serving the pastor, deacon, singing in the choir, greeters, and Sunday school teachers, that's the work they talking about. They never turn it back on me. I overcame. Tina, give me Revelations. Let me find it. I think it's Revelations 21, verse 21, if I'm not mistaken, verse 21. And 6 through 8. Let's get that one. Amplified Classic Edition. Let's throw this in there right quick before we get moved. So there's a process of you becoming holy. Now, here go the deal. You was birthed into holiness, but now you got to renew your mind into holy thinking, because the average person thinks, well, I believe in God. That belief does not constitute salvation. Well, I was told once saved, always saved. No, Jesus said those who endure to the end going to be saved. What if you quit? What if you give up on God's way of doing things? And he, here we go, further said to me, this is God talking to John, Jesus talking to John on the Lord's day. It is done. I am the Alpha and Omega. We people saying that and don't even know what that means. Well, how, if he's first, then how you putting him last? Why is he last? Why is he the last resort? If he's number one, then 10 don't jump in number one spot. Number 8 don't go to number one. How do number one get replaced with me, myself, and I? Me, the me church. It's the me church. It's selfish. It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, the one who thirsts, I myself will give water without price from the fountain springs of the water of life. We're talking about the word of God. Come on, listen. He who is victorious shall inherit all these things. What do you mean? Victory is mine. mine. We sang it. Victory is mine. You see, he who is victorious shall inherit all things. And I will be God to him, and he shall be my son. And you don't get, because all life started with a man. Women come out of Adam. Women and children come out of Adam. So all life started with, that's why son is there. But is he God ain't sure with us now. But as for the cowards and ignoble and the contemptible, the cravenly, lacking in courage, the cowardly, the submissive, as for the unbelieving, listen, faithless, and for the depraved, and the defiled with abominations, as for murderers, look at the category put coward people in. Look at it now, unbelieving people. Look at the category, murderers, lewd, and the lewd, and adulterers, and the practicers of magic art, people who love to read the horoscopes and dealing in witchcraft and trying to put voodoo on somebody. It's people still doing that crap. Idolaters, people who make God out of things. Because whatever is taking your the number one spot in your life is pretty much a god. Yeah, and God said, thou shalt have no other gods before me. The rich young ruler said, Lord, I kept all the commandments. I didn't commit adultery. I obeyed my parents. Jesus said, he beheld it and said, go and sell some of your stuff. Give it to the poor and follow me. You'll have treasures in heaven. The rich young ruler went away sad at that saying. Why? Because he broke the first commandment. Jesus showed him. He said he kept all the commandments. He showed him, you broke the first commandment. Thou shalt have no other god before me. His money was his God. Jesus located him. He went away sad because Jesus busted him. He said he done everything. Jesus letting him know. Now, that was an impressive list. But one thing can keep you out. Sell some of that and give it to the poor. He couldn't do it. And the Bible said he had great possessions. No, great possessions had him. Come on. Come on. Come on. Listen. Magic arts, idolatry, those who give supreme devotion to anyone or anything other than God. That sums it up right there. And all liars, those who knowingly convey untruth by words or indeed. You ain't saying nothing but your actions, your mannerism, your lifestyle, the way you live, says you are untruthful. All of these shall have their part in the lake that blazes with fire and brimstone. This is the second death. All right, Tina, let do this for me. I mean, Jeremy, I'm sorry. All right. Give me, because she was back there Friday night, and I'm still stuck in Friday night, forgive me. Give me John 3:16. John 3:16. I want y'all, because we see once saved, always saved. We got to get to what believing is. You ever seen anybody doing something that they don't believe? I just can't help it. I'm just addicted. The word addicted means devoted. So anything I ever built up habit and was loyal to, I once upon a time loved it. Sin was my nature, so I sinned. Then I found out I was a slave to it. Then I found out when I didn't want to do it, I found myself doing it anyway. Now, some people think Paul was saying, when I don't want to do it, I find Paul was speaking as an unbeliever. He was not speaking about himself. He was saying, when people are sinners, they don't want to sin, but they find themselves doing it anyway. That wasn't Paul like. And so many, even Paul, God had him to live that away and write something contrary. That's crazy. Come on. For God so greatly loved and dearly prized the world, the people in it. Name the category. All them people we just named in Revelation are in the world. That he even gave up his only begotten unique son so that whoever out of that list believes in, listen, trust in, clings to, relies on. That's what real belief is. So when you believe in something, you ain't coming off of it. So do we really believe? What can turn you off of God's word? When you a believer, ain't nothing going to change my mind because I'm truly convinced Jesus is Lord. He proved that to me. Come on, watch this. Now, trust in, clings to. When you cling to something, you become one with. A man shall leave his mother and father and cleave unto his wife, and the two become one. Relies on him, shall not perish, come to destruction, be lost, but have eternal life. Now, how many really gonna believe? If you believe, you can overcome. The reason why you ain't overcoming is because you don't believe. That is right there. Come on, Bridget. For God did not send his son into the world in order to judge the world. No. Jesus came to save the world. Second coming, he coming to judge. He coming as a judge. He came as a savior on this trip. He coming to save. To reject, to condemn. He didn't come to condemn on the first trip. He came to save. Woman, where are your accusers? I don't have any. Go and sin no more. Why did Jesus tell a woman who was caught in adultery, go and sin no more if she couldn't overcome it? Come on now. Jesus don't tell people to do things that they can't do. He don't tell people to stop doing things that they know. And there wasn't no Holy Spirit at that time. Okay, the reason why Jesus said don't go, he gave her order because he was under dunamis and a youth. He was under power and authority. Go and sin no more. The power in go and sin no more. If she had obeyed it, she could have overcame. We don't get that, do we? If you trust in that living word, the power is in it to get you out. Cain, why are you angry? Cain, did not God locate the boy? If you do well, I receive you, which means God ain't receiving people who deliberately do wrong prior to the churches there. Because a lot of churches, you can live any kind of way. Just say you're sorry. Now, get this picture. Somebody, we got cross up there. That ain't the one he hung on, but he actually was nailed to a pine tree. It was pine. I did a search on it, and it was a pine tree. Because they didn't want to keep making crosses. Pine got sap in it. What do sap do? Preserve the wood. So they didn't want to keep making crosses there the other day with other wood, so they made crosses that most people, they had to use over and over. But anyway, somebody died on a cross for everything we named in that list over in Revelation. And now we get to say, today now, I'm sorry. Somebody was beating their testicles. He was naked. He didn't have any clothes on. He was uncovered so you wouldn't have to be. He looked at inhuman. Every disease and sickness went in them. That's why he looked inhumane. And we say we sorry and that's supposed to fix it. What about changing? What about letting that sin nature go? Come on. That's what he wants. That's when he knows. You know you godly sorry. Because I hear people, I'm sorry. Sorry ain't going to fix it because I've seen people say they sorry and 100 more times they doing the same thing over and over. You ain't sorry. You just sorry you got caught. That's all that is. Come on. Now, in order to judge or to reject and condemn the past sinners, he came to save us on the first trip. The world, but that the world might find, see there, he didn't come to judge on this trip. Salvation and be made safe and sound through him. How do you do that when you don't believe in him? When you won't trust in him? When you don't cleave to him? Trust in the process of salvation's foundation. I trust this because I'm not the same no more. I'm not the same person that I used to be. I'm thank God that I got peace in my life now. All right, 18, watch this. He who believes in him, who clings to, trust in, relies on him, is not judged. That's a believer right there. He who trusts in him never comes up for judgment. Why? Because the one you trusted in took your punishment. He took your beating. Amen. Get it? So if you're a believer, you ain't finna choke somebody out for $20 and your sin debt will forgiven $10 million. Hear me? He incurs no damnation, but he who does not believe, cleave, become one with. See, when you cleave to something, you become one with it. To rely on, trust in him is judged already. Why? He has already been convicted. He has already received his sentence. The gavel been hit on the prostitute who won't change. Jesus died for the prostitute. She ain't going to hell for prostitution. The murderer ain't going to hell for prostituting. The thief ain't going to hell for thieving. He won't accept Jesus. That's the sin. That's what you're going to hell for, because you won't come under and submit to him as Lord. That's what we're studying about in Sunday school. He's Lord. I know he's Lord. And I'm gonna be a company man. I'm going to be a snitch. I'm going to be whatever. I'm all in. I've been all in with the devil. And come to find out, that low good and sorry stinking devil tried to say, now, look at your life now. After following him, he said, where are your so-called friends at? I was by myself, sitting alone in my mama's house with a gun. The devil said, where are your friends at? Look around. You ain't got a job. You gave your car away. Won't you kill yourself? Sounded good. I had a gun in my hand. But a light switched on. This soft voice came to me. What's missing out of your life? I said, Jesus. How did I know the answer? I dropped the gun, got on my knees, and said, Lord, forgive me. Save me. That was on a Thursday. I was 17 years old. Went to the corner where I usually hang out at, right across from Charles Lambert's house, by Miss Hawkins' house, cat, where the bus stop, J. Tran bus stop at. I was sitting up there, Lord, what am I going to do now? Coach McQuitter came by in Hines Junior College Station way. Soon as I repented, God had somebody in the making waiting on me. Can you still play ball? You got a ball? Can you pitch? Yes. I told her, because he said, come down and try out. I ain't giving you no scholarship. You're going to have to make the team. Hadn't played since I was 14. Walked on. Hadn't in school and hadn't even took my GED. When God opened door, but I had to finally take it. But I'm in class, taking college courses. Without a GED. But the man that he put me under was hard. Oh, he went to breaking, and I met with him Thursday. I said, you, God put you in my life to prepare me for ministry. I learned ministry on that baseball field, because I would have gave up. I would have quit ministry if I hadn't have been under that man who wasn't going to accept losing. He taught me, you don't accept it. He ran us because we beat the team probably about 15-3. They shouldn't have got the 3 run. You're running because you had your foot on their neck and you didn't break it. We have the authority over Satan and we won't finish him. We won't take authority. Then he come back and wipe us out because we got the authority and we want to play with it. Ooh, Satan, you here cute. You look like a little puppy. Yeah, he looked like a little puppy. See, I've been there. I've been there. God put some people in my life to help shape me for the people I was going to be pastoring. If I hadn't have went up under that man, I would have walked away from this church. In my spirit, I did. I quit. God whooped me. 9 months of verbally rebuking me. And when God, and I did love him, but I didn't love him enough to obey him. When God got off me, I ain't been the same since. Let me tell you one thing, God is not playing with. Your soul is important to God. Everybody in here, you can play with it, but Daniels ain't playing with your soul. I'm going to tell you the truth. in love that you may grow up. And if you rejected it, it's on you. You're going to have to bow. You're going to have to confess and still be sentenced to hell. This is the reason. Put it back up there, Jeremy. This is the reason why people end up in hell. Not because, listen, receive this sentence, because, not because he has not believed in and trusted in the name as Lord and Savior, the only begotten Son of God. He is condemned for refusing to let his trust rest in the name of Jesus. That's the sin. He died for every sin. You name it, he died for it. But since you won't trust, well, I say, always say, a lie. Don't let these jackleg preachers fool you. I know the truth. And everybody in here can overcome anything that come in your way. Because the victorious one, if he in there, you can overcome. You better check, greater is he. If he's there, you can. But it's going to take some teaching. It's a process. It's a process. I didn't learn how to play baseball in one rip, 1 year. Learned how to catch and throw and pitch the first year. I learned how to hit and become consistent the next year. Doing it over and over, the same thing. Wake up and live holy every day. Wake up and live holy. Doing the consistent, basic fundamentals of baseball. Doing the same thing over and over and over. You get good at it. Living for God over and over. And what's the problem? We still stumbling and tripping? What's wrong? Something wrong, man. Yeah, we got to trust the process. I trust the process. And I thank God. And he even said, he said, God sent you. He said, I said, God sent you to save me first. And he told Jeremy the story. Did he not tell you the story? He was finna take some pills. And I was looking for him. I found him. I didn't give up. God said, find him. What if I had disobeyed the unction from the Holy Spirit? That man would have been dead. Because I had enough faith to not to give up. You going, when you seek, you're going to find. You can't find a job. That's a lie. How much it make? That ain't, that, no, no, no. I'm going to tell you what it pay. It's going to pay humility. It's going to pay learning you how to submit. That, you can't put a number on that. We worrying about how much it pay. Something you ain't going to be willing to. See, we got this thing wrong. The kingdom has millions, zillions of ways to get what it need to get to everybody in here, but I only need one of them zillion ways. I don't need a zillion. I only need one way, and God got the way to get everything he want to get to me. Yes. And the way of his humility coming under. Telling you, I've been there. So, the outcome write this down. God will not hold us accountable for the outcome, only for your efforts. He's going to hold you accountable. Where we at, Jeremy? Come on. We got to finish this one because you got to get this. The reason why I'm going over it, because you got to get it. This is the basis. This is the reason God is letting us know. Jesus is letting us know. This is the reason for the indictment, the judgment, the test. What? The test? Yeah. By which men are judged. The world, mankind, are judged. This is why. See, can I say something? There's good works and bad works. What we're going to find out right here, they were working all along. But let's see what kind of works they were working. The grounds for the sentence. Ain't it funny, you the gavel been hit in the courtroom, case dismissed, you guilty. Well, don't I need to know what the charges are? I think we all would know what the charges is if Jesus came back and hit the gavel on him. Who would in here would like, well, I'm going to hell. But you would know if he sentenced us to hell, wouldn't we? Wouldn't we know based on the scripture, all right? In this is the sentence. This is, it lies in this. Light. Jesus is the light of the world, has come into the world, and the world is dark. And people have loved the darkness rather than and more than light. For their work, see, they were working all the time in the dark, were evil. They had works, but they were evil works. They believed in what they was working. You don't go to hell for nothing. You was at work, but it was dark works. Come on. See the reason for the indictment? For every wrongdoer hates Los that test the light. Who want to go to a well-lit, sinful place? You want to go where it's dark, where you can't be detected. And if a joker is sitting up in a church with shades on, doing a funeral, that's an indication he in darkness. The light is too bright. He know it's bright up in there. He don't want to be exposed. Why are you wearing shades? And what's that about? Well, he was just been crying, eyes swollen up. That ain't what that is. We right here. But every wrongdoer hates, loathe, detests the light. He got to put some shades on and will not come out into the light, but shrinks from it. That's what the shades are about. And least his works, his deeds, his activities, his conduct be exposed and reproved. Come on. Come on, give me 21, please. But he who practices truth, don't wear shades, who does what is right, comes out into the light so that his works, may be plainly shown to be what they are, wrought with God's divinely prompted, done with God's help in dependence upon him. That's where we at. So, when LaFran was alive, I gave him one of these. I had people staked out in the church. They had these on, sitting all in the congregation. What is this? Why you got a mask on? Don't you want somebody to really see you for what you are? If you're going to be what you're going to be, then, hey, come on out. That was a song out when I first got saved. Are you a closet Christian? Hide in your faith. Why would you put on a mask? This ain't Robin and this ain't Batman. Why wouldn't you want somebody to see who you are clearly for what you are? But people show you who they are all the time. They deeds. You see what they're doing. You hear their speech. They can't deceive you if you detect the verbiage. Can you be saved and wear one knee? How many people that are saved? You said, you know that they say they saved, but they got one knee on. May keep you guessing. Peekaboo. I ain't got to guess. You ain't got no business with nothing like this on you. You finna rob somebody. Unless you come through Jesus, which is the door, you come as a thief and a robber. Amen. Where we at here? All right. Imagine. Can you imagine this? Let's everybody play imagine here. Growing up in a perfect state. Let's say Mississippi was perfect. Can you imagine growing up? Ain't no wrong. Everybody downtown, the chief of police is, well, we don't need a chief of police. There ain't no crime here. It's perfect. Everybody in position are the citizens. We don't lock our doors. There's no jails here. It's perfect. The rats ain't running from the cat. Cat ain't running from the dog. It's perfect harmony. No weeds in your flower bed. It's just perfect. Can you imagine it? Now, here come some people coming into this perfect state with an imperfect mind. What's going to happen to the state? Think about it now. This is perfect. But what about the state of mind the people are in? What's going to happen to the state? Come on, y'all. Get with me. Be free to comment. Comment. Anybody. What's going to happen to the state when people come in with their state of mind not lining up with what's going on in the state? It's going to cause an infection. But ain't that what people think they're going to do to heaven? God hit me with that. But why is it they think with no renewing of mind, we go into this perfect place called the presence of God, heaven, cleaned up, prepared for his people. And we ain't renewed. We ain't overcome nothing. We still just believe he died and rose. What's going to happen? Well, let's put it in proper context. Adam and Eve were put in the Garden of Eden. Eden means God's presence. There was nothing wrong in that look. See, one thing you got to know about God, he don't start you off with a big old world. They had a little old spot. I'm going to say about big as this pulpit and pew all the way from here to there. The garden. It was there of the run. God didn't give them a whole lot. Gave them a little bit. As long as they saw it the way God saw it, was it perfect. What happened to cause chaos in Eden, meaning God's presence? Wait a minute. Did they trust the process God gave them? Don't touch. Did they trust the process? Don't touch this tree. The process was to keep it running perfectly. Don't touch it. Now, they could harvest the fruit and bring it to God because that belongs to God. What belongs to God, you can't deal with. See, we taking what belongs to God and say it's ours. Don't touch that. Adam, you made like me. You could function like me, but I'm putting something in this garden to put differentiate between me and you. I'm God. You are the creation. Don't overstep me. Don't touch it. Now, here come another thought saying, okay, what did God say? What turned them off the word of God? What is the authority of God? His word. Long as they was in obedience, was it perfect in the garden? What caused it to be unperfect? When a house ain't ran off the word of God, what's in it? And we say we say, what's in it? Chaos, a lot of hostile. It's the same thing going on in the earth. It's the same attitudes and stuff that's coming up in God's house. And some reason these pastors are telling the people that heaven is going to be just like that. Can you picture that? I gave you a picture of how a state of Mississippi was perfect. But the people won't renew their mind. What's going to happen to the state? Same thing happened to the God. What came in? Who came in? Say it. What did he do? Sold them a different story than what God said. And the church has been hornswoggled to believe something else. Well, what about them lost books? I say, are you doing everything in Matthew? Are you doing everything in Mark, Luke, John, Romans, Acts, Corinthians, so forth? Did you master those 66? No, what would you need to know about them lost books for? They ain't lost. They're not anointed. They're not attached to the 66. So I don't care about that. We can't handle Psalms. We can't handle Proverbs. You worrying about something God didn't give you? A person got mad. You ain't even obedient. You can't even give your neighbor. You can't even love your neighbor. And you worrying about something lost? So, what's going to happen? The outcome of our state is not on us, but our efforts and our state of affairs. God is going to hold you accountable for your actions and what you're doing. The outcome belongs to God. Now let's go to Micah 6 and 8, Ecclesiastes 9 and 1. We right where I need to be. I did all that to get there. Yeah. All right, where is my, wait a minute, here we go. The Greek for the word process, 1382, I found another one, trial. God is going to put you through trial, proving. God want to approve of you. He want to approve character in you. Your character got to be proven that you are like Christ. Proven worth. God want to show you how what your worth is by testing. Micah 6 and 8, Brother Jim. Micah 6 and 8. Let's get it. He has shown you. Hasn't God shown you? He's shown me. Do you see that? God has shown you. Who is he? Oh, man. what is good. God know my heart. Yeah, he do. And what does the Lord require? I don't know. What did your boss require? You ain't fired. So you know the requirements. I just don't understand why somebody got to read the Bible and study the Bible. It don't take all that. What does the Lord require? What does the Lord require? And see, that's what we're getting here at Kingdom Faith. Our purpose statement keeps us in regulations of bringing souls into the awareness and the accountability. Ain't nobody going to hold me accountable. Well, go find a church like you know where and let him lie to you and fleece you. I don't have what it takes to fleece you. I don't know how to do that. I'd rather just be straightforward and let you choose which is your destination. You can choose to go down further down south or go up north. Up, kingdom, down, hell. That's your choice. You make the decision. I can't choose for you, but I done made my choice. What does the Lord require of you? Ask yourself that individually. But to do, the just shall live by faith. He's talking about the just, the one who has been justified in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And to love kindness. Hasid, God never takes you off his mind. You ain't an afterthought. You in the forefront of God's mind. Where is God at with you? And mercy. God loved us so mercy because one day I'm going to need it. I give it out because one day I'm going to need some mercy. And to humble yourself. And to walk humbly with your God. Total dependence on God. Didn't Jesus do that? Didn't Jesus do that? So what's the problem? Do we know what he wants? We got to learn how to walk with God. I agree with God. I don't wrestle with the scripture. I tried that. I had a lot of people, I tried what you do. It didn't work. I said, well, I ain't none of you. But why you say that? It's working for me. You know how many people I have had trying to change my mind off of what I've been teaching y'all. Let me tell you one thing. It's working for me. This stuff is working for my life. And they trying to get me off. Why would I let a goof mouth, a goof got up, take me off of something that's working? It ain't working for you, but it's working for me. Why would I change? That's crazy. I can't do that. I will not do that. Jeremy, give me Ecclesiastes 9. Do we know what the Lord requires? Do we know how to walk humbly with God? You got to agree with God. Well, God got on me. I'm still mad with him ever since 73. You better hurry up and get unmad. Because God laughing at you. What did that scripture over in Psalm? I think it's Proverbs or Psalm. God going to laugh at you when your calamities come upon you. 11 verse. Stand in, give me verse 11, Jeremy. 9 and 11, and then we're moving on. I got somewhere to go. So the outcome is up to God. God is causing it to grow. What if you out of position? Return. I returned and saw under the sun. Don't say it's unfair. Don't say things ain't going your way. Don't ever say you didn't get your shot. Or you didn't get your chance. Because this scripture is shooting down every black person who pulled my out. I returned under the sun that the rays and saw. I returned and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift. The fastest don't always make it first. Because fast people can get tripped up. Y'all don't hear me? So a lot of people started off ministry and shot off past me. They ain't pastoring no more. Some of them are even dead. They're not even at a church. They still looking for a church. I'm still in the same place where I was sent to. It ain't the fast. They thought they were more knowledgeable because they was sounding like Martin Luther King, Marshall Thurgood, trying to have good verbiage and diction. I just came in the power and the demonstration of the Holy Spirit calling stuff out. Who you think you is? You ain't this and that. I'm saying what the Lord said. They had a problem with that because I was sent. They don't want to hear that. They want to talk about Daniel in the lion's den. They want to talk about Aunt Betsy made fine hoe cakes and Miss Rubella deep fried chicken. They want to make sermons on that kind of stuff. No. I was teaching them what had happened to me. They didn't want to hear that because they were reminding them of where they was. I returned under the sun and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift. Just because you're the brightest and the smartest, you'll get your chance, but the ones who ain't that bright and smart gonna have their chance. And all of it don't favor to the educated and the smart. God, this is a level playing field with God. God, when they cast lots, and back then they had a way of picking people and deciding, God allowed them lots to fall where they needed. God is all in the circumstance. Everything that happened just don't happen. It happens for a reason, and God is orchestrating all of it. You can bet your last dollar on that one. Come on. So don't say, it's just, we black people always going through. You're going to get your chance too. Nor the battle to the strong. Yeah, neither is bread to the wiser. The one who is the wiser don't get all the bread, nor riches to men of intelligence. Everybody going to get their chance. But understanding, listen, and understanding, nor favor to men of skill. It ain't about all them. But time and chance happens to them all. God is responsible for the outcome. You're responsible for the what? For the effort. Now, most of the people I've seen, when the opportunity came, they weren't ready. Why weren't you ready? People are so busy complaining, when the opportunity came, they missed it. They didn't recognize it. Or they weren't ready. Whose fault was that? Who fought with that? You can't say God is unfair because he's not. Yeah, black people have been through a lot, but we don't have to continue to get the cycle. The cycle been broke a long time ago. Jesus tore that sucker up. He tore it up. Do you hear me? So, listen. Process, trial, proving, approve, character, proven character, proven worth, test. Give me, Brother Jeremy, give me, let's see, Romans 5:1-4. Let's get that, Romans 5:1-4. And I want you to understand something. Be ready when God get ready to test you and try you to grow you on up, because God is going to try all that. I'm being tested. I'm being tried. God said, I'm testing the foundation. That's along with me too. My fifth year, he said, tear up everything that's been taught here. Everything that's been taught and relay it with the word of God. Have we not been doing that? This is our book right here. For Jeremy, you got it? All right, come on. Therefore, since we are justified, what do God require for you to be just? He wants you acquitted, declared righteous. Therefore, since we are justified, acquitted, no charges can be brought against you when you come into Jesus Christ. Romans 8, there is no condemnation to them who are in Christ Jesus. Did y'all get that one? Oh, I love that one. Acquitted, declared righteous. You are declared righteous. Fred Hammond got a saying. Call me righteous. I'm a brand new creature. The old sin nature been destroyed. They can't lay that up on you. That thing gone. But we still identifying with that old sinful nature. Why? If you've been acquitted of it, why you don't keep running back to it? Declared righteous and given a right standing with God. You've been given a right standing with God through faith. Let us grasp the fact that we have the peace of reconciliation. And not only that, we've been given a ministry of reconciliation to hold and to enjoy peace with God. How is it that so many people say they got peace, but ain't peaceful with people? The peace of God helps me to be peaceful with everybody. I'm looking for peace. I can find a common ground with everybody. Yeah, I can. Don't mean I agree with what you're doing, how you're living. I'm just not going to go be at odds with you. I'm going to find a peaceful avenue that we can both walk in. God, peace with God, through our Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Anointed One. Come on. Through him, through who? Him. Also, we have access. Do we trust this process? Entrance, introduction, by faith into his state of God's ain't fair. A lie, it is fair, in which we firmly and safely stand. Let us rejoice and exalt in our hope of experiencing and enjoying the glory of God. Can we rejoice and exalt in our hope of experiencing God? I experience God every day, and I'm looking for new experience, but I want to milk everything out of this one experience. I don't want him to take me too fast. Enjoy the glory of God. Three, moreover, let us also be full of joy. Why is he talking about joy? Where the happiness go? Joy is released out of your spirit. From the attributes of God, from love come joy. Now let us exalt and triumph in our trouble. What? All hell breaking loose, glory to God. Man, look at the hell coming at me. Hallelujah. Trouble. Come on, baby. You don't hear that. Why me, God? Why not you? We long as the sun is shining, we good. But let us exalt and triumph in our trouble and rejoice in our suffering. Why? Knowing that pressure and affliction and hardship produces patience. I like this word here, unswerving endurance. You ain't all over the road. You're walking a straight line, baby. And endurance, fortitude. The process develops maturity of character. Process. And your faith is approved and tried integrity. Ain't nobody in the room and you still got integrity. You ain't looking around trying to see who. Produces the habit of joyful and confident hope and eternal salvation. Now you see why so many people don't have hope and they're enjoying their eternal salvation. There's too many people on their way to glory. It looks like they've been drinking green persimmon juice and lemon juice and lime juice and vinegar mixed, and they passing it as a hors d'oeuvre with cocktail wieners in the church. What's the hang about? What's the madness about? Where the joy? I'm going back with it. Hallelujah. But in the meantime, hell is knocking on my door. Come on in. I've been waiting on you. Now I get to see do dunamis and the use of your work. Bring it on. I'm ready for it. Because God ain't going to allow it to come if he know you can't handle it. Time and chance going to happen to them all. Come on. This is good to me. Do y'all get this? Such hope never disappoints. When Abraham looked at Sarah's body, because they kept getting in God's way, didn't they? Abraham prostituted his wife, had her dressing like a hooker to save his life. Is this your wife now? Pharaoh took her, and God said, don't you touch that woman. That's Abraham's wife. Call him here. Why did you get out of Egypt? Leave. Take the gold. Take silver. Take some cash. Abraham got rich. Get out of here. You done brought trouble on me. Abraham kept getting in God's way. Finally, God said, I'm going to wait till y'all get old and decrepit. So 25 years passed, and Abraham looked as Sarah looked at itself and looked in the natural, didn't have no hope. But he had hope in what God said. And he kept hoping. See, the world ain't got nothing but natural hope. We got a supernatural hope. Y'all better hear me. Abraham kept hoping and believing. Come on, y'all. Come on, y'all. Such hope never disappoints or deludes or shames us. For God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, which is the first installment of all the blessings of coming. Great things are ahead for me, Michelle, and the church. And doggone it, I'm getting ready for it. Well, I'm going to sit back, get me some lemonade, and sit in a lawn chair under the oak tree and wait on God. No, I'm developing. I'm renewing my mind. I'm getting ready for it. Now, the outcome is on God. But the effort is left up to me. We think, and what the preachers have said, you ain't got to do nothing but confess Christ and go back to living a sinful life. A lie. Come on. Come on, we got to get all the way to 10. Listen, has been poured in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. The first installment, Ephesians 1, 13 and 14. Is that not there? All the blessings to come. You got the first installment, the Holy Spirit, then all the other promises, yes and amen. Now, it's an extraordinary thing for one to give his life, even for an upright man. Come on, Brother Jeremy. Come on. And listen. Though perhaps for a noble and lovable and generous benefactor, some might even dare to die. That's Jesus. But listen, but God showed and clearly proved his own love for us. And this, you got to prove your love. The Bee Gees had a song, How Deep Is Your Love? God, you're going to have to prove yourself to God by the fact that while we were buck wild, doing it up, girl, I was something back in the day. We all know you were something. We don't want that picture. Christ, the Messiah, the anointed one, died for us. While we were jagging it up, somebody would die. Had died. We had to come into the knowledge. Ain't that something? Since we now are what? Justified, acquitted, made righteous, and brought into right relationship with God by Christ's blood, the blood did it. How much more certain is that we shall be saved by him from the indignation and wrath of God? Let's get verse 10. Let's jump in here and anchor down right here. If while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, it is much more certain now that we are reconciled, that we should be saved daily, delivered from sin's dominion, baby. Every day, every day, every day, every day, every day, every doggone day, daily delivered. And you think I'm going back to Sinville, Povertyville? I'm not. Put that back up there, man. Do you see, reconcile, that we should be saved daily, delivered from sin, dominion through his resurrected life. Now, doggone it, there's too many people celebrating Resurrection Day. I'll help sin and come to the glory of God. God, know my heart. You know how you're trying to do it. You sin because you want to. The outcome is yours. No, the effort is yours. Outcome, God has already stated the outcome. You can't overcome what? You can't overcome what? Don't sit here and lie to me. What the word say? I'm going to side with the word every time. We can't see ourselves doing it. You go to the average person and you tell them that they're going to cuss you out. They're going to speak in unknown tongues. In known tongues, you bliggity blank, 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 so and so, so and so. Forgive me, Lord. Well, I ain't cursed since I got filled with the Holy Spirit. That was in 86. Ain't had a desire to. Those words, some kind of way, left me. And I had a testimony in that place. When I stopped smoking, I started studying the Bible in the place of smoking. Whenever God took something, I put him in that place. Amen. Come on. Do y'all get this? Do y'all get it? Do y'all get this? Do we get it? All right, I got somewhere else to go. Philippians 2, 10 through 16, and we out of here. So, the outcome. Now, can I say this right quick? The three stewards, the message we're given, one had five, one had two, and one had one. The outcome was left up to God. The effort was left up. The first steward gave an effort. He gained how many more? He gave five more, which gave him 10. The effort of the second steward, he had two and gained two more. The effort of the last steward, what was it? Is that the church? Kumbaya, my Lord. Kumbaya. Come by here, oh Lord, if you don't stay long. That was that song. No. That one steward, he your talent is. I knew you was a hard man, reaping where you had not sowed. what was the outcome? God could have been the same as the first two. So people are failing because their effort is a failure. They won't give a true effort to really be saved because the preachers have told. And I know some of you have heard this. You saved. All you had to do was confess and get baptized. He joined church at an early age. I was at a funeral, and Big Cat, you know it. And the boy was down, everybody know he was this and that, and he got up when they give people to speak. He got up there. Y'all know this was a scown up here, and y'all up here talking like, I ain't gonna get up here and say all that. Everybody knew what that boy was. His life exemplified what he was. Why do we try to dress that stuff up? He lived his funeral. Let me leave that alone. But the pastors have told y'all. Give me 12, Jerry. You right, 11. Give me 11. I like that. I like every tongue. Every tongue. Frankly, and openly confess and acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, to everyone who have done this, you're saved. Now, this is what we got to do. Therefore, my dear ones, as you have always obeyed my suggestion, so now, not only with enthusiasm, baby, you got some passion like we went after sin. I'm passionate about doing for God like I was breaking in them. I used to have breaking in car seminars. I told y'all. So now, not only with the enthusiasm you would show in my presence, but much more because I am absent. Work out, cultivate, carry out the goal, and fully complete your own salvation with reverence and awe and trembling self-distrust. Quit trusting in yourself with serious caution, tenderness of conscience. Let everything, when your conscience is tender, thing bother you. You ain't got a seared conscience no more. Watchfulness against temptation. You got to be on guard. Timidly shrinking from whatever might offend God. Get away from it and discredit the name of Christ. Ain't nothing wrong with doing that. We saved. Ain't nothing wrong. That's what the church saying today. Well, if God's letting you get away with it, then God's going to have to apologize for Jesus. He goes, because he whooped them and beat, had them whooped for sin, and he died for sin. For you to be free to just have at it. He's going to have to apologize for me because the stuff he told me was wrong for me and people said it's right, then God owed me an apology. All right, you're going to let them do it and I can't. Something wrong. God ain't letting them do it. They got their own God. You know, we write our own Bibles. We'll see if it's going to last in that day. Here we go. Here we go. Not in your own strength. Your daily delivered, but not in your own strength. For it is God who is all the while effective, like work daily delivering you, energizing and creating in you the power and desire to both to will and to work for his good pleasure and satisfaction and his delight. Do all things without grumbling. Bro, go out there and tell that truck driver to do this and do that. Well, I ain't none of my job. And you wonder why you ain't got a raise since John got out the army. My dad named John, he got kicked out of the Navy. Fault finding and complaining against God. Who is it against? You think it's against the boss, a man, or the boss, a woman. No, it's against God. It's against the pastor. No. No, it ain't. It ain't never against me. It's against God. Always against God. I ain't taking it personally. Questioning. What's the question about? Doubting among yourself. Listen, that you may show yourself to be what? 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 Blameless. Can't nobody live right. Just say you don't want to live right. Okay? Guileless, innocent, uncontaminated children of God. Without blemish, faultless, unrebukable, in the midst of a crooked. What's wrong with this generation? Crooked. When the wicked eye rule, the city mourns. What's going on in the city? Wicked generation, spiritually perverted. What? This generation is spiritually perverted? Perverse? Among whom you are seen as bright lights. Star. You want to be a starer? Here you go. You want your 15 minutes of fame? You get a whole light to shine for God. Beacon shining without shining out clearly in the dark world. Here your star go right here. Show Hollywood how to do it. these rappers, these ungodly musical people, show them how to do it. We the true stars. And we think Hollywood is it. Don't we want to be like them? Holding out to it, offer to all men the word of life, so that in the day of Christ, I may have something of which exalted to rejoice and glory in, that I did not run my race in vain. See, you can run your race in vain, or spend my labor to no purpose. You can do that. And how many people this might end up happening? Nobody should end up living a life in vain here at Kingdom Faith, because we know the truth. And I'm closing with this remark. God told me Friday, when I walked into the church Friday night, and I told Joe Nathan, he was here, and I think Tina, you were there too. God said, how you got a business, but instead of advertising your business, promoting your business, you are promoting someone else's business more than your own. I already knew where God was going with that. He said a church has been promoting the world more than the kingdom of God. God don't lie. I knew that was God's voice. Why are we talking more about the world than we are talking about the world to come? Why would God have to say that to me? Why is the church promoting? Yes, we're in the world, but we're not a part of the world. Chip, little flock, I deprived the world of its power to harm you. The world is evil. It's perverse. It's crooked. Why are we promoting that? I'm a company man. I'm talking company. People don't even want to talk to me because I'm going to talk about the Bible. It just comes up. I'm sorry. I done fooled myself. I done indoctrinated myself. Well, it used to be all about sin. Man, you want to learn something? Let me show you how to do this. And it was all wrong. I had a lot of students. I'm not proud of that stuff. God showed me. He said, you taught a lot of people some wrong stuff. I thank God that he's given me the opportunity to teach the right thing. No, I'm not going to fleece you. I'm not going to tell you to go out here and sin. Have fun. Now, I lied. Let me get this one more statement. All of us in here, we have never confessed Jesus Christ. All of us are adults, and teenagers, young adults. We are living as sinners. We go to work every day. We work every second on the hour. We punch out for lunch. We come back on time. We on time every day. And we obedience to our parents. We are married. We don't cheat on our wives. Wives are not cheating on us. We're not emotionally tied to nobody and like that. And we just obedient. We help out the poor in the neighborhood. We go to the hospital. We feed the hungry. And we do all those great things. But when we get ready to die, where will we go? Where will we go, y'all? We going straight to hell with a one-way ticket. Why? We were morally good. We didn't commit adultery. We didn't go to clubs. We didn't drink. We didn't smoke. We ain't lied. We ain't did nothing. But went to work and came home and loved on our family. The children was obedient. They cleaned the room up. They washed the dishes. They mopped the floor. They cut the grass. They did everything the parents said to do. Where would we go? Hell. Because we did not accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, who took away our sins, disease, poverty, and pain. Get it? But the morally good people say, my efforts are going to get me into the kingdom. Somebody lied to you. And I'm not. I don't have in me the gullible to mistreat you and tell you it's all about motivating you to go out and make money. I can't do that. It ain't about the money. Because if I am trying to fleece you, I'm doing a poor job of it, ain't it what? You tell us about it the truth, they'll be to shot you, man. Jesus said if they hated you, hated me, they're going to hate you. Amen? So saints, trust the process of the foundation for salvation. God has shown you, old man, what is good. Let's walk humbly. Let's come under the authority. Let's show the world all you stars in here. Let's go out into this dark world and crank that sucker up. Let's shine. when somebody asks you, why you live the way you live? Paul said, through the power of the Holy Spirit, be ready to tell everyone who asks you why you live the way you live. Tell them why. Because you saved, set apart for the master's use. Satan used me. God gonna get the greater use out of me than Satan ever did to me. That sucker like to kill me. He ain't getting that chance no more. And I'm gonna tell y'all something. You wanna sucker punch the devil? You wanna choke him out? Don't do what he said to do. Don't do what he suggested. That's how you hurt him. They done caught on. They don't listen to me no more. He gonna hurt. He gonna get a little feeling. Go somewhere and sit down. This is our word for the day.